Welcome to Notes on Nature TV. I'm Jamie.
And hello, I'm Luke.
And in this video, we've got loads of fascinating and wonderful wildlife to lift your spirits.
So I'll be taking a look at Britain's smallest birds, the goldcrest and the firecrest. And of course, there's all the excitement of the Big Garden Birdwatch, which is coming up very soon.
And Dr Amir Khan introduces us to the bird feeders in his garden and gives us loads of ideas of the food that you can put out to help attract birds for the birdwatch later this month.
And I also have a mealworm feeder, which is really popular with great tits and blue tits and the starlings too. And they love that. And again, if they drop anything, the robin will be there in a flash.
We've also got TV broadcaster and RSPB President Miranda Krestovnikoff introducing us to the intriguing world of a kestrel nest.
So I find the easiest way of working out male from female kestrels is the female's got a striped banded tail, so they're striped all the way down her tail, whereas the male's tail is pale colour with this dark band right at the end. So that is actually the male kestrel.
And we'll also have a fantastic moment of calm with a prize-winning poem from Matt Howard.
To listen to the short descending arc of willow warbler song whilst working. See sunlight on the nodes of a Norfolk hawker's forewing.
But first and foremost, a look at some of the fascinating and fabulous pictures that you've been sending in to us.
So the first picture we've got here is a fascinating one. This is an acorn weevil. Tell us a little bit about this one, Luke.
So this is an amazing creature. An acorn weevil is actually kind of a new one on me. I know weevils. I've seen various weevils kind of in my garden, out on my walks around, you know, nature reserves and just out in the countryside. But yeah, the acorn weevil, what a fantastic looking thing. Looks almost exotic with that sort of long, thing that sticks out the front of his head. Now that is actually called a rostrum. And at the end of the rostrum, they've got little mandibles that can chew through the outside of an acorn. And that's how they get inside, because they need to lay their eggs inside the acorn. So obviously the outer shell of an acorn is pretty tough. So those little jaws need to be pretty strong and chew their way through. But yeah, what an exotic and bizarre looking creature.
So the grubs of that weevil will grow inside the acorn, and they'll feed on the acorn and then munch their way out, somehow get back out again, won't they?
Yeah, exactly right. And I know that some weevils actually lay their eggs inside other living creatures like caterpillars, and they use that rostrum. That's our fancy word of the day. They use that rostrum to get inside and lay those eggs.
What I can't get over, just finally on this weevil, because I've now become obsessed with it, is the end of the rostrum. You're saying there's little tiny jaws at the end of that spiky bit.
Yeah, on this picture, you can kind of almost see that the end is slightly split. I mean, if you really, really zoom in on the picture and take a really close look, you can see it's kind of split. But yeah, that's the, you know, if you think of something, there's other creatures that just pierce things with, you know, like an ovipositor, for instance. That's a good example that just simply pierces through the outer shell of something.
And that's what in other sort of invertebrates use to lay their eggs, isn't it?
Yep. So yeah, absolutely. An ovipositor. Yeah, that's where their egg comes out. But yeah, with the weevil, yeah, they don't just push through. They can actually chew through the outer shell. It's amazing.
That's extraordinary. So do bear that in mind if you ever see a weevil. It's got tiny, tiny little jaws on the end. And the next photo we've got here is a lovely little stone chat. And the fact that I know about these is that they make a sound like two stones being banged together. A little bit like a robin, I suppose, aren't they?
Yeah, so these are great birds, and one you see a lot in winter. So we've got a big breeding population in Britain that'll be found in our uplands and on our heathlands and scrubby areas. But we get a lot that come in just for the winter as well. You never see one stonechat normally. This is a male in this picture, and it's really unusual just to see one on its own. I bet you that there was a female really close by. Pairs are really loyal to each other and never stray far apart from each other. And another fascinating thing about stonechats is that we know that lots of birds have a breeding plumage and like a winter plumage. Now, this stonechat isn't as bright as what it'll be in the summer. But what happens is if you look really closely at that bird's face, just around the eye and the beak, you can see it's very, very black. And what's going to happen over the next few months is those feathers around the rest of its head are going to wear and tear and turn blacker and blacker. So in the spring, it'll actually look really slick and fresh and really bright and vibrant. But actually, that's down to the wear and tear of its feathers and not actually growing new feathers in the spring to look all smart.
That's amazing. Well, thank you. And thank you, Isabel, for sending that one in. And the next one we've got here is this fungus that's been sent in by Nigel Pierce. I'm not great on fungi. Have you got any idea what this one is?
Yeah, so I think this one's pretty unmistakable, actually. This is the Dryad's saddle. And it's actually one of our bigger fungi that we can see out and about. It always grows in several layers, generally on broadleaf trees. I think this one's on the base of a hawthorn by the looks of it. But yeah, really quite common fungi, usually seen kind of summer into autumn. But yeah, pretty unmistakable. I think it's one of our biggest, so it can get to about 0.5 meter in diameter. And these things have been known to get so big that they can't actually stay connected to the tree. They fall off under their own weight sometimes. So that's kind of how big they are. These are not poisonous. Of course, with fungi, you need to be extremely careful if you're handling. And, you know, some are edible, obviously. But it isn't something we'd recommend unless you're a total expert. But this one isn't poisonous. And it's supposedly, when fresh, supposed to smell and possibly taste a bit like melon.
Interesting. So, yes, a word of caution there. Don't go out and start grabbing fungi unless you really, really know what you're doing. But dryad saddle is interesting because a dryad is a kind of a tree spirit, isn't it? It's that's where the name comes from.
So dryad saddle is presumably a really old name, and a lot of fungi have alternative names as well because they just go back over many, many generations. So I bet there's alternative names for this one. Do you know of any, Jamie?
Yeah, so one of the alternative names for this particular one is pheasant's back, because the coloration, it doesn't look a little bit like the color of a pheasant. But there's also scaly polypore, which doesn't sound quite as appealing.
Yeah, I don't think I like scaly polypore. Let's stick with dryad saddle, eh?
Yeah, dryad saddle is the one. So the next photo we've got here is from Barry Inman, and this is a really lovely one of spoonbills. Now, spoonbills feature in quite a big way in the next issue of Nature's Home, which RSPB members will be receiving around this time, or may have already got. And we were celebrating, really, the fact that in 2020, a pair raised their chicks on our Havergate Island Nature Reserve. And that's the first for over 300 years. So they're doing quite well now, aren't they, in the UK?
They certainly are, Jamie. And in this picture, actually, you can kind of see that you can see the success before your very eyes. Now, on the right is an adult bird, which is pure white. But you can see the bird on the left has lots of black tips to the white feathers, particularly on the longer flight feathers or the primaries that we call them. And this is really likely. I mean, I'm not exactly sure what is going on in this picture, but it looks to me like it's a youngster chasing an adult and clearly after some food. So this is, you know, success before our very eyes, a young spoonbill with an adult.
Wonderful thing to see. And they have been successful at all sorts of different sites. I'm not going to list them here, but I know that in 2020, we had 6 pairs producing 3 young at our Fairburn Ings Nature Reserve in North Yorkshire, as well as the ones I mentioned at Havergate Island. So something to look out for, I think, in the coming years is this growing number of spoonbills. And they're returning to the UK. So they were originally here, weren't they? This isn't a new thing. They would have been here hundreds of years ago.
Yep, totally. They were here. But now they're clearly back in big numbers. You just mentioned some places where you can see them there. And a reserve not far from me is RSPB Arn. And the record there is nearly 80 spoonbills in the autumn. And they clearly like to gather there kind of as a migration stopover. And I know that just the other day there was 30 seen in Poole Harbour as well. So, yeah, clearly the numbers are rocketing up.
Now, the next photos we've got here, we've got 2 from Claire Green, who was lucky enough to watch this great spotted woodpecker mature over summer as it visited her garden. And the first photograph, what I quite like about this one is that it's got this little red cap on top of its head. And I always think a way to help me remember that this is a young great spotted woodpecker is it's like a little school cap. It's wearing its little cap to go to school. And I think it looks quite sweet in this one.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, so that red cap is definitely the giveaway of a juvenile. But this also trips people up because if you look in your bird book, you'll see probably on the same page that there's the lesser spotted woodpecker. And this is an extremely rare bird these days. Even when I started bird watching kind of 20 years ago, it was already a very rare bird and hard bird to see. Now it's even rarer. So, you know, very, very unlikely in the garden. But the male lesser spotted woodpecker also has a red head. Now, the next picture is, of course, the same woodpecker, but grown up. And you can see in this shot that it's lost its red head. It's turned black. But you can see at the back of its head, it's retained a little bit of red. And that tells us that this is a male greater spotted woodpecker. So the juvenile has turned into a fantastic grown-up male woodpecker. The females have just got black on the back of their head. So, during your big garden bird watch, which is obviously coming up, take a close look at your woodpeckers, your greater spotted woodpeckers, and see if you can tell the difference between the male and the female. So that red is the male.
As you say, the Big Garden Birdwatch is coming up soon. You could take part from Friday the 29th to Sunday the 31st of January. And here's Dr. Amir Khan with some wonderful tips on how you can feed garden birds. And who knows, maybe you'll attract a woodpecker to your garden.
I attract a lot of finches on my feeders. So we get lots of goldfinches, loads of greenfinches, and we're really lucky that we get bullfinches as well that come in lovely little pairs. And they love sunflower hearts. They absolutely love it all year round, but particularly in the winter because they're full of essential oils and fats that are really good for overwintering birds and helps them survive kind of frosty cold nights, those kind of things, if we get them in good health. I use sunflower hearts rather than whole seeds because the shell is being taken off, so the birds don't have to fuss around with that, and I don't have to clean them up off the floor later as well. So it's a win-win for both. I also have suet balls and coconut halves, which are really good for the winter in particular. And they are, again, full of oils, fats, that kind of thing that will help birds over that cold spell. And actually, just before I came out, there was about 8 or 9 great tits on one of the coconut halves that were just like feasting away, and when I came out here I frightened them off. But they are really, really popular, and they're popular with starlings and when the little birds kind of drop parts of it on the floor, then robins and blackbirds will come and clean up for me, and the odd pigeon, to be fair, but we don't mind that. I've also got a peanut feeder and a special feeding device, because that you have to be very careful with that. You don't want birds to swallow peanuts whole. And I am very lucky. I get a woodpecker on there that absolutely loves it, but also great tits, blue tits, love that as well. And we get coal tits in the garden, which is really, really nice. And I also have a mealworm feeder, which is really popular with great tits and blue tits and the starlings too. And they love that. And again, if they drop anything, the robin will be there in a flash and get all of that. So that is what I feed my birds over winter. It's so, so important. And the other thing is, make sure you put fresh water out, because often their water sources are frozen as well. So they need fresh water every day.
So that was fantastic. I love Amir. And he gave us some fantastic tips there for our own big garden bird watches. Sunflower hearts, that's definitely what I use. But we've also had this video in from Molly from our Wildlife Inquiries team, who explains a little bit more about why we do the big garden bird watch at this time of year.
So it takes place in winter because although it doesn't seem it, it is actually the time we're more likely to see birds in the garden. And that tends to be because of the weather and because of the lack of natural food. The food we put out in the garden is much more alluring to them. So they're much more likely to come and kind of make the most of our food offerings. It's also the best time because sometimes in the summer, when we've got lots of juvenile birds and lots of molting birds, they can look very different to our kind of bog standard classic images of birds that we use to identify them with. So by doing it in the winter, it's their standard plumage that everyone will be able to recognize. So that's the best time to kind of be able to spot and identify the birds. And in the spring, when birds are nesting, they can be quite secretive because they've got all their nest for their babies. So they don't want any predators to spot them. So they're actually more secretive. They'll be more likely to hide. And because of all of those babies, we're more likely to have a lot of birds in the summer that isn't really very representative. So although it seems wonderful, we've got all these birds that we can see, in the winter, that'll actually be the number of birds that have survived in the hardest time. So it's a much more representative time.
You can sign up now for the RSPB's Big Garden Birdwatch to get advice tailored just for you at rspb.org.uk/birdwatch. Coming up, a lovely, relaxing moment with Matt Howard's poem, Chrome, and RSPB President Miranda Krestovnikoff shows us inside the nest of a kestrel.
So the kestrel's just flown into the box literally just a second ago. I'm not sure if it's the male or female. I'm guessing it's the female at the moment because she's been in pretty much every night.
Before that, here's me talking about our smallest birds in Britain, the goldcrest and the firecrest, and some identification tips. So in this species spotlight, we're looking at the goldcrest and the firecrest, and we're going to kick off with this little chap. This is the goldcrest. Now you can see on his head there why it's called a goldcrest, that fantastic yellow stripe that runs right down the centre of his head. Now they're a very lively little species, flitting from branch to branch, and that's often how you actually spot them. Now goldcrest and firecrest share the accolade of being the smallest birds in Britain, weighing in at about 5 grams, which is the same as a 20 pence piece, so really are tiny. Now this is the firecrest, and you can really see why it's called a firecrest. That stripe down the middle of its head is fantastic, and you can also see that it's kind of highlighted further by that white stripe above the eye, and that is how you identify a firecrest as opposed to the goldcrest. Also, firecrests have these very sort of golden shoulders that make it look a much brighter bird overall. Now, the firecrest is quite a rare species. You're much more likely to see a goldcrest flitting around in your garden during the winter. Now, both species are kind of resident in the UK. We have a big population of goldcrest breeding, and lots join them in the winter from Scandinavia. But firecrest is a little bit different. They occur in the south as they migrate in the autumn time, but we do have a breeding population that's actually increasing as well. So it is a species that you are more likely to see these days than you were, say, 10 years ago. Now, the goldcrest and the firecrest can't be attracted to gardens by feeders, so they're one that you're going to have to plant lots and lots of native plants and shrubs that attract insects, so that kind of is the only way to get them in your garden. But what an absolute joy it would be to see one this winter, and I really hope you do get to see one.
Well, that was fascinating, Luke. Thank you for that video. And goldcrests are something that I've encountered quite a few times up at the lodge, the RSPB headquarters, in some of the conifer trees. And I'm surprised how close you can get to them. Is it because they don't sort of fear us? Are we too big and they're too tiny?
I wouldn't say that's the case. I would probably suggest it's because it is to do with their size, but because they're so small, they have to concentrate on feeding all day long. In the middle of winter, you know, if the temperatures are barely getting above freezing, like I mentioned, these birds only weigh about 5 grams. So they really are tiny, and they need to concentrate and feed on insects all day long. So that's probably why they're just ignoring us, Jamie.
They're just little eating machines, aren't they?
Pretty much, yeah. I mean, insects are pretty hard to find in the winter. I mean, I don't, you know, on my walks around, I don't see many. So, you know, I mean, they're tiny, and their eyesight's much better than mine. So, but yeah, little eating machines. I like that.
Now it's time to pay a visit to the kitchen of RSPB President Miranda Krestovnikoff, where her family have been enjoying amazing views inside the world of a kestrel nest.
I have always vowed that I never wanted a TV in the kitchen, but we've got one. This, however, is the monitor that feeds into our kestrel box, and this gives us a 24/7 live view of exactly what's going on in that box. And without this, we'd have no idea about the lives of our kestrels. It's brought us really close to these beautiful birds and really brought them into our home. Certainly my children are so engaged with their lives and their behaviours as well, because we've got this rare and really quite secret view of what goes on. So it's just beginning to get dark out there now, and I'm hoping that the female's going to fly in any minute. She seems to be coming in most evenings, and she'll come in and preen and then just sort of settle down for the night. And occasionally she's joined by the male, or the male might come in by himself as well, but we'll just wait and see. So the kestrel's just flown into the box literally just a second ago. I'm not sure if it's the male or female. I'm guessing it's the female at the moment, because she's been in pretty much every night. So it's just beginning to get dark outside now, and this is her habit pretty much every day. She comes in at this time, so we all turn the monitor on and expect her to fly in, and we can watch her as we have our dinner and then breakfast. Oh, actually, that's the male. So he's just gone to the back of the box, and you can see that you can see clearly see the tail. So I find the easiest way of working out male from female kestrels is the female's got a striped banded tail, so they're striped all the way down her tail, whereas the male's tail is pale colour with this dark band right at the end. So that is actually the male kestrel. Juvenile males look quite like females when you look at their faces, so, and especially when it's black and white and quite dark, I find that's the easiest way of telling the two apart. So we have had the male and female in the box together for quite a while, although over the past few weeks it's generally been the female that's been using it overnight. The male's been coming in very briefly and then just flying off again. So I'm actually expecting that he won't stay there very long. He likes to hang around at the back, where she tends to spend most of the evening at the front of the box. Obviously there's a big opening at the front, so she can look out and see if there's easy prey for pickings.
So that was fantastic footage. And of course, those kestrels are using that nest box at this time of year as a safe place to roost. But that's a really good sign that they're using it at this time of year, because chances are they will go on to nest there in the spring. And we really hope to have more footage from Miranda in the coming months to be able to show you. So that's really, really exciting.
Yeah, thank you very much, Miranda. That was wonderful to see. And we will have more videos coming up for Miranda in the next few episodes of Notes on Nature TV. Matt Howard, who works in our campaigning team, is, outside his day job, an incredibly talented poet. And his first anthology of poetry, Ghoul, was awarded a prize. It's the Best First Collection Prize in the Laurel Prize for Poetry. Now, the Laurel Prize was founded by the poet laureate Simon Armitage, and it celebrates nature poetry that highlights the environmental crisis. And here's Matt reading one of the poems from his book.
The poem I'm going to read comes from being a volunteer, really. So this is about me getting away from my RSPB desk, because my job is decidedly a desk job, but getting out into the Norfolk Broads, working on a piece of fen with a friend of mine to bring more nature back to his patch of land. And the poem, and I don't want to over-explain the poem, but the poem is called Chrome, which is spelled C-R-O-M-E. Now, a chrome is a hand tool that you would use for habitat work, for physical habitat work. So if you imagine a garden fork, but instead of the prongs being straight with a chrome, they're bent at 90 degrees. And the idea is you use that, as the poem's going to describe, to particularly to clean out ditches. And the reason why you might do that is because if you clean out all of the dead leaves and vegetation, you get more oxygen into the water. If you get more oxygen into the water, you get more plant life. Get more plant life, you get more insects. You get more insects, you get more mammals, you get more birds, you get everything. So this poem I'm going to read for you is called Chrome. Now imagine this as all my definitions of what it is to chrome. So imagine taking that noun and making that, turning that into a verb. Chrome, to cast a tool of ash and hooked iron, to take care in boots at the edge of standing water, to throw from the shoulder, then heave from the lumbar spine, to clear a dike of leaf fall and slub from the past three decades or further, to feel a suck and pop of sedge roots tearing from bog, to spit splashback of fested water from one's lips, to wretch one's balance of vows and curses when no one else is listening, to imagine a cut of clearer water, to hull deeper with long draw tines, to blister then callous both hands in unfavorable conditions, to consider the phase wing strokes of dragonflies, to listen to the short descending arc of willow warbler song whilst working, to see sunlight on the nodes of a Norfolk hawker's forewing, to act with the whole body and mean it.
That was incredibly relaxing. Well done on the prize, Matt, and thank you for reading that for us. We hope you enjoyed Matt's poem and this episode of Notes on Nature TV.
But that is it for now. So thanks for watching, and we will see you next time.